Welcome to Moments of Truth, a CEO leadership video series. Today we'll be speaking with Pam Patsley, Chairman and CEO of MoneyGram. Let's hear what she has to say. Well, Pam, thank you for being on Moments of Truth. I really appreciate you being here.
Great. I'm delighted to be here with you.
Okay. Why don't you tell us a little bit about MoneyGram and the whole money transfer industry?
Basically, it is a person-to-person, consumer-to-consumer cash remittance business. Mm-hmm. And most people talk about it as cross-border remittances, and that's about two-thirds of our business. But our single largest, you know, from here to there, mm-hmm. is actually U.S. to U.S. Our consumers are everyday people all around the globe that actually are not getting their financial needs met by traditional banking institutions.
So what drives volume in this business? Is it migration? Is it what typically drives how much remittances go on?
Right. So unemployment is kind of a good marker world over, but, you know, because it's our worker, they might be in construction, service industry, the laborer in large numbers. Mm. But it is really exactly, it's migration. It's leaving one's home country to find a better way of life and to provide for one's family.
So who holds the fund? So if I come into a store here and I give the money, there has to be that amount of money over there to be given to a person. How does that work?
Yeah, I think a good way to think about it is that MoneyGram runs a very large settlement engine. Every day we're collecting on a net basis, you know, from on a Walmart basis, they're a sender and a receiver. Okay. Many of the U.S. to U.S. transactions are also picked up in a Walmart. Mm. So we settle with Walmart daily, or we settle with all of our agents daily, kind of net of their send and receive transactions, which includes then those that are receive only getting funding.
Tell me about what attracted you to the position of CEO of MoneyGram when it was going through over $800 million worth of mortgage-backed security debt implosion and some other issues that were going on. What was that like? What attracted you to that opportunity of a turnaround, and what did you learn from that experience?
Well, I learn every day, still learning, so there's no end to the learning part. Mm-hmm. And I would say what attracted me is the opportunity to really take a company that had a set of amazing assets. You know, the service we provide, there's an element of it, it's a very important service because absent a formal channel, that money still needs to get home, mm. and the alternatives are less secure, less reliable, more expensive. I loved the fact that it was at the heart a recurring revenue model business, you know, and what got the company in trouble, they took the eye off the core value creating engine of MoneyGram. Mm. And they got very excited about the opportunity to play a huge float balance that MoneyGram holds, largely generated from official check processing and money orders, and played that for yield. The long-term value creating engine, it's not going to be growth in check processing, it's money transfer. I mean, it is a huge global industry. We're the number two player and 5% market share.
How do you decide what the priorities should be, and how do you get the organization back on a firm footing, you know, morally and so on?
Yes. It was about refocusing everyone around what was going to create value, what was going to create long-term growth, and, you know, the power of the brand. So centering around what was important, laying out some goals, and we laid out early on, we should be growing double digit. So we just kind of picked easy phrases, double digit network growth, double digit transaction growth, double digit revenue growth. And someday we'd like to also have double digit margin expansion growth. Uh-huh. So yes. Not there yet.
I know a lot of companies that are global in the sense that they operate in many different countries, but really their mindset and the way they run their operations are not truly global. What do you think it takes for a company to be truly global, both in scope, operations, and mindset? What kind of people and what kind of processes?
It takes a lot of work, and you can't take your eye off that. This is not a U.S. conversation, just because I sit here in the U.S. or because I do, and our CFO and our general counsel. It is, you know, the conversation could be mostly about Russia or China or Angola, Brazil. It could be anything. Mm. And we all have to, you know, just inculcate ourselves in it's a global business. And no one place is more important from a business perspective. There's size differences and everything.
Do you find that you benefit by having executives move around different offices, or do you try to do that deliberately? Or?
We do try to do that. I think it's great for individuals, and I want them to think of MoneyGram as a great place for both professional and personal development. Mm. I benefited myself. I think my family benefited when years back we had the opportunity to move to Paris, France for 2 years. Mm. Professionally, personally, a wonderful experience. I encourage anyone who has that opportunity. And so with that belief, we have to offer those opportunities as well.
What experiences did you have? Was there a particular moment of truth where, boy, this is a really important aspect of my learning, and this is something I'm going to carry forward as I go in my career?
Yeah, maybe it's because I'm the daughter of two teachers. Uh-huh. I feel that it doesn't stop. You know, you should have an insatiable appetite for learning, and each next experience informs the next. I also, and I think what was helpful was, I was energized by it was similar, but it wasn't the same.
Interesting.
You know, make it different. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's more interesting, and I think, I don't know, something about the ethics of it that feel better.
What about from a leadership perspective? What helped you kind of solidify or crystallize your leadership style and what you believe allows you to be successful in getting others engaged and moving mm-hmm. forward?
Well, I think I've had some great mentors in my professional career, and I think you've also always come across people that you see, oh, I need to make sure I never do that. Hmm. So there's the positive mentorship, there's the awareness of, you know, what doesn't work well, or how people feel on the other end of something that may not be a style that you say, I really don't ever want to emulate that. And I must say, it comes back to, you know, your whole foundation as well. And I think I had just amazing encouragement from my parents, and, you know, a foundation of great ethics and communication and a positive attitude and outlook.
So how do you look at your kind of skill set and fill in the gaps? How do you?
Well, I think you need someone, you know, as CEO, you need someone with all the skill sets reporting to you. And my goal is to hire everyone that's smarter than me. Yeah. You know, when people say, well, what skills are you looking for in your leaders? Great communication skills. And you have to, when oftentimes someone isn't, quote, at a home office or even an office, they're a work from home regional compliance officer, you know, in some part of Asia or something. So you have to communicate often and very clearly and consistently.
All right. Well, Pam, thank you so much for being on Moments of Truth.
Thank you. Appreciate really it. Enjoyed visiting with you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Many thanks to Pam Patsley for sharing her insights with us today. And thanks to you for watching. Please join us again next time for more CEO insights in Moments of Truth. I'm Mickey Quiñones for SMU's Cox School of Business.